As we try to unravel Earth's history, we look for signs in the landscape that provide indications of former episodes of extreme climates. In North America, we recognize evidence of a recent ice age and wonder if it has ended, or are we just in a brief warm interlude before another cold interval?
We have two learning objectives for this lesson. First, to discuss the characteristics of ice ages, and second, to consider how the changing extent of glaciers and ice sheets is influenced by other components of the Earth system.
We can identify several ice ages during the last billion years of Earth's history. During these times, thick glaciers and ice sheets covered large regions of Earth. Extensive glacial deposits provide evidence of massive ice sheets that may have extended almost to the equator near the end of the Proterozoic era, creating a condition known as snowball Earth.
Ice ages in the first half of the Phanerozoic era indicate times of cooler temperatures and lower greenhouse gas concentrations. The most recent ice age, the Pliocene Quaternary, began less than 3 million years ago, and many scientists interpret data from this event to suggest that we are technically still in this ice age. During its maximum extent, a sheet of ice a couple of miles thick would have advanced southward out of Canada before retreating again as climate warmed.
So why do we get ice ages? Ice ages last for millions of years and are generally related to the relative positions of continents and oceans. As you might expect, locating continents over a pole allows ice to build up and may result in an ice age. This was the case for the events of the Karoo Ice Age, when several pulses of glaciation occurred over a span of about 100 million years in the Paleozoic era.
However, 3 million years ago, the distribution of continents was not much different from today, with one significant exception. Water was flowing freely between the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans through a narrow gap that separated North and South America.
That gap soon closed, and circulation patterns in the Atlantic Ocean changed, leading to more humid air carried further north and resulting in an increase in precipitation and the development of ice sheets in northern latitudes.
Contrary to what many people think, ice ages are not continuous times of extremely low temperatures. For example, examine this graph to see how temperature varied during the last 450,000 years. This includes the most recent part of the Pliocene Quaternary Ice Age. As you can see, an ice age is actually characterized by a series of shorter climate cycles composed of alternating pulses of warmer and colder temperatures.
We can observe a series of longer cold intervals known as glacials that are interrupted by shorter warm intervals known as interglacials. These alternating cold and warm intervals reflect the advance and retreat of glaciers.
The interglacials last for 10 to 20,000 years. We may actually be in an interglacial now, or maybe the ice age has ended. We'll just have to wait about 10,000 years to find out.
If you look more closely at the graph, you can see that even within cold glacials, there are significant fluctuations of temperature resulting in colder and warmer intervals. All of these changes can be explained by small changes in the shape of the Earth's orbit and/or the inclination of the Earth's axis.
Temperatures in the polar regions become colder if Earth's orbit takes it farther from the Sun during winter, and if there's an increase in the tilt of Earth's axis. Over the course of tens of thousands of years, these types of changes have the potential to drastically change Earth's climate. When they all align in just the right way, they can lead to substantial warming or cooling trends to generate glacials and interglacial cycles, as well as shorter, more frequent cycles within these intervals.
Okay. So now we know that several long-lasting ice ages have been triggered in Earth's history due to changes in the relative positions of continents and oceans, and that climate cycles through warm and cold intervals during these events. But what causes an ice age to be sustained or to end?
We'll consider the factors that help sustain an ice age to be positive feedbacks, and processes that lead to the end of an ice age as negative feedbacks.
Perhaps the most significant positive feedback arises from the ice itself. Ice and snow make very reflective surfaces. The term albedo is used to describe the reflectivity of a surface.
Bright, shiny, or light color surfaces have high albedo values and will reflect solar radiation. Reflection results in less solar energy being absorbed to the Earth's surface and produces a cooling effect.
In contrast, dark surfaces like forests or oceans have low albedos and will absorb solar radiation and become warmer.
Positive feedbacks in the climate system would result in larger ice sheets. Ice sheets reflect solar energy, causing less to be absorbed, and leading to a decrease in temperatures and thus sustaining the growth of the ice sheets and prolonging the ice age. Further, the growth of ice sheets would diminish the area of the globe covered by dark ocean waters and forests, further reducing the solar energy capable of being absorbed.
In contrast, negative feedbacks represent processes that result in an increase in temperature that would encourage melting of the ice sheets and the expansion of the oceans and forests. This might result from gradual changes in the distribution of continents and oceans, or from an increase in atmospheric carbon dioxide concentrations. Carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases would trap heat close to Earth's surface, accelerating the collapse of ice sheets. Such an influx of gases could result from volcanic eruptions or from the decrease in photosynthetic activity due to cooler temperatures.
So for today, we had two learning objectives. How confident are you that you could successfully complete both of these tasks?